dancing in the rain. I'm happy again. My troubles have fled. A rainbow's ahead. I'm singing, singing. I'm singing in the rain.
Judy Garland was born as Frances Ethel Gumm on June 10, 1922 in Grand Rapids, Minnesota. Ever since day one, Judy had been around the entertainment business. Both her parents were vaudeville performers, which sparked Judy's interest in the entertainment world at a young age. She was only 2.5 years old when she performed with her two older sisters, and they eventually became known as the Gumm Sisters. During this time, Judy was given the name Baby by her sisters and parents. The Gumm Sisters, and subsequently Judy, made their film debut in the 1929 short The Great Review. The Gumm Sisters' name did not stick, however, after being laughed at during a performance at the Chicago Theater in 1934. A man named George Jessel recommended that they change the Gumm aspect of their name, and eventually they settled on Garland. 1 year later, in 1935, Frances changed her name to Judy after hearing the popular Hoagy Carmichael song, Judy. After that, the legend of Judy Garland was born. Judy had it hard growing up thanks to her mother, Ethel Gumm. Ethel knew Judy had star qualities to her, so she would give Judy pills. She provided her with uppers to perk Judy up during her long work hours, then downers to help her fall back asleep again. The use of these pills began a lifelong substance abuse that no matter how many times Judy tried to kick it, she never could, and they would eventually even take her life. In 1935, Judy would be hired by MGM, and this seemed like a huge opportunity for Judy. However, this would open her up to judgment in ways that no person would ever want. According to MGM, she was either too old to play any child characters, but also too young to play any adult characters, and this ended up putting her into an odd limbo of sorts, but eventually they settled on a girl-next-door look for her, something that Judy never really liked or even wanted. She was also deemed too ugly and fat compared to all the other actresses out there who were really well-known at the time. She was basically starved by getting fed nothing but chicken broth and cottage cheese. Then, along with her mother giving her pills already, the studio began then giving her their own pills that would help her lose weight. All of this caused Judy to have major self-esteem issues and worsen her reliance on pills for weight loss and deepen her addictions. She was also sexually harassed by the then head of the studio, Louis B. Mayer. One instance of this was him putting his hand over her left breast while claiming it was because he loved her singing voice. She was, however, able to put a stop to this harassment as she got older. In 1938, Judy got paired up with Mickey Rooney in the film Love Finds Andy Hardy. Her and Rooney became lifelong friends, and even after her death, Rooney always talked about how amazing Judy was. This pairing allowed Judy to continue to get work from MGM until she landed a role that blasted her career upwards and allowed her to become an acting and cultural legend. In 1938, MGM began searching for its Dorothy Gale for its big movie musical, The Wizard of Oz, set to release in the next year. The then young actress Shirley Temple nearly got the role, but she was under contract by 20th Century Studios and they would not let her go. So, Judy Garland got the role. During the filming of the movie, she was given tobacco to curb her hunger and kept strictly on the pills to help for weight maintenance. Her co-stars also bullied her on set as they were jealous of the relative newcomer getting so much more of the limelight over them. There are also unconfirmed stories that she was sexually harassed by the Munchkins as they would try to look up her dress. Thankfully, not only was the movie a modest success, but it also was able to help show Judy's acting and singing abilities and managed to get her the Juvenile Oscar that year at the 1939 Academy Awards.
For the outstanding performance by a juvenile actress during the past year, Miss Judy Garland.
The film even got nominated that year for Best Picture but lost to Gone with the Wind. With the success of The Wizard of Oz, Judy went on to star in three more films in 1940, and in 1941, she met and married her first husband, David Rose. Later that year, Judy got pregnant, and despite her wanting to keep the baby, both her mother and the studio executives got her to get an abortion because they thought audiences wouldn't love Garland anymore if she was a mother. Then in 1944, her and Rose got a divorce. This sadly wouldn't be the first time Judy got unlucky in love, as she would go on to get married four more times before her death. In 1942, Judy got the chance to team up with the then newcomer Gene Kelly in the hit film For Me and My Gal. The film proved to be a smash hit at the box office and not only launched the film career of Gene, but also allowed for Judy to keep getting more adult-orientated roles. In 1944, Judy got one of her biggest hits ever with Meet Me in St. Louis. The film also had three of her most well-known songs, including the Oscar-nominated The Trolley Song. There was also Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas, which has been covered by various artists over the years and considered a holiday classic now. This was also the first time that she felt a little bit confident in her appearance thanks to her new makeup artist, Dorothy Ponadel, as she did away with a lot of the modifications that she was normally given by the studio executives. This was also when she met her soon-to-be second husband, Vincente Minnelli, who directed the film. The two got married in 1945, and in 1946, they had a daughter named Liza Minnelli, someone who would go on to have her own very successful career. In 1951, Judy walked into Minnelli in bed with another man, which caused Judy to try and commit suicide. Judy had never had anything against gay individuals, and his true sexuality was never 100% confirmed, but they did eventually end up getting a divorce later that year because it was just a loveless marriage at that point. 1945 through 1950 was a time of ups and downs for Judy. In 1945, The Clock came out, and it was her first fully dramatic role. It did both well critically and financially, despite audiences being a bit surprised that she did no singing in it whatsoever. In 1948, Judy got another huge hit with Easter Parade, but unfortunately, this is about the time that her drinking problems became very, very prevalent. She would come in late for many shoots, and sometimes just not at all. This unfortunately ended up causing her to become suspended by MGM. Judy eventually ended up at the Peter Bent Brigham Hospital in Boston, Massachusetts. During this time, she was able to get off her medications and was able to kick her alcohol abuse. It was a very liberating period for her, and she felt very refreshed by the time she had to leave the hospital. Right after she got out, she went right back to work. Sadly, however, when she began her work on the 1950 film Summer Stock, she went right back onto the pills to lose the weight that she had gained while at the hospital. While the film did well with critics and at the box office, the extra cost for Judy being late and the missing shoot days ended up losing MGM an entire $80,000. In 1951, Judy had a small but highly successful tour around Britain and Ireland where she performed in front of sold-out crowds. Not only were they sold out, but she also got high critical praise for her performances. She was very happy during this period as she felt that she had been given a new life. During this time, she got married to her tour manager and producer, Sidney Luft, of whom she had two children with. Lorna Luft in 1952 and then Joey Luft in 1955. 1954 was the year Judy arguably got her biggest role ever next to The Wizard of Oz being A Star is Born. The 1954 Star is Born is actually a remake of the original 1937 version that starred Janet Gaynor. The original was a drama, but the remake was made into a musical, which is something that has stuck with the 1976 and 2019 remakes of the film. Judy started out strong at the beginning of filming, but kept getting sick and causing more and more delays, which in turn caused the production costs to rise. Despite the strong praise from both critics and audiences, the movie unfortunately did not make its money back and the studio ended up suffering because of it. Judy suffered as well as she was financially unstable at the time and didn't make as much money from the film as she had hoped. Judy was, however, nominated for the Oscar for Best Actress that year, and despite everyone thinking that she would win, in a major upset, it went to Grace Kelly for her work in The Country Girl.
The award for the best performance by an actress, Grace Kelly for The Country Girl.
After the failure of the movie, Judy could barely find work anymore because no one wanted her after getting a reputation of being very hard to work with. So during 1955 and 1960, instead of doing film, she began to make appearances on TV shows and specials. She constantly got good ratings on the different appearances she had on TV, which eventually led to one of her biggest, yet short-lived, successes, The Judy Garland Show. In 1961, CBS offered Judy $23,000 to create The Judy Garland Show. It was a musical variety show of guests like Barbra Streisand and her lifelong friend, Ray Bolger. Sadly, despite critical praise from both audiences and critics, and even getting 4 Emmy nominations, it just didn't get the ratings it needed to make enough money for a second season. This was really unfortunate for Judy as she really needed the money for the show to pay off all her debts that she owed to the IRS after not paying her taxes for 2 years straight. In 1963, Judy began doing tours again, which had mixed results. Some performances got her praise from audiences. However, one infamous performance in Melbourne, Australia, she came in over an hour late and seemed to be intoxicated. The audiences then booed her off the stage and ruined her ability to perform for a while. Later in 1965, Judy divorced Luft as she claimed he beat her. However, he claimed he only hit her in self-defense. All while this was happening, she and her tour manager, Mark Heron, became married later that year. This marriage was short-lived, however, as they separated only 6 months later and then became officially divorced in 1967. During these years, Judy's money situation had only become worse and worse due to poor management by her agents at the time. She ended up having to sell her house at a low price out of desperation for money. In 1969, the final year of Judy's life, she got a gig in a nightclub in London for 5 weeks. It was also in London that year that she happened to meet her final and fifth husband, Mickey Deans. Tragically, on June 22, 1969, just 4 months after her marriage, Deans found Judy dead in their bathroom that morning. The news of her death quickly spread all around America and millions of people began to mourn for her death. During an autopsy, it was discovered that Judy's death was due to an accidental suicide because of an overdose of barbiturates. It's been over 50 years since Judy's death, but her legacy has only increased over that time. She has been heralded as one of the biggest and best entertainers who have ever lived. There have been countless books, interviews, and films about her life, including the 2019 biographical film called Judy, starring Renee Zellweger, which received 2 Oscar nominations and winning one of those for Renee for Best Actress at the 92nd Academy Awards.
And the Oscar goes to Renee Zellweger.
Despite her untimely death, her legacy will never truly die, and she will be forever celebrated by millions around the world. This has been the life and the legacy of Judy Garland. Thank you so much for watching.